one of the things that was tasked on me was the whole workers' comp stuff. We didn't get it passed this session, you know, not for lack of trying. We got it passed out of the House unanimously. It landed over in the Senate. So Texas Municipal League, Texas Association of Counties, they're the two that are on record testifying against the workers' comp bill. They are there for your employer. That's it. And your employer's bottom dollar.
Welcome back, listeners, viewers, watchers, voyeurs, Blue Grit Podcast. I'm your host, Tyler Owen, and
Clint.
Thank you guys for tuning in, watching,
listening.
You guys hit that subscribe button. We greatly appreciate it. We got a special guest today, good friend of mine and friend of law enforcement, John, the man, the myth, the legend that walks the Capitol hallways every day during session, Wilkerson.
AKA JW.
JW. Welcome back, man.
Hey, man. Appreciate y'all having me back.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We wanted to have you on to kind of give a overview of the 88th session.
Yeah, I appreciate y'all giving me a little bit of time to let the craziness go.
Well, it's not like you have a busy schedule that we've been begging you to come back and kind of give one, and that the session hadn't been kind of prolonging and Governor Abbott had been kind of continuing the session anyway. So
yeah, we're looking at coming up on our third special. It's already, it hadn't been announced yet, but it's already, talks are there.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, me and Clint wanted to have you on.
Tell the world who is J-Dub. For those that didn't see you on in the past.
Or that don't know you.
J-Dub.
Yeah, so, you know, I've been in law enforcement coming up on 19 years now. Still commissioned, working for Bell County Sheriff's Office. I work full-time for Tmpa. Started off here at Tmpa 2012, so was that 12 years ago? Came to work on the grants, some of the grant programs that we have, and promoted up through that. And then 2015 came across the street. To be a field rep, worked as a field rep since 2015, and then, late 2020, I believe it was.
Yeah, I think so.
You know, the position came open in government affairs, and I thought, man, that's something I never really had any interest to do, but, you know, looking at it going, I haven't done it.
And you're a glutton for punishment?
And I'm glutton for punishment at the time, yes. Yeah. You know, so I figured, you know, that's something I haven't done, and I always like a good challenge. So I came over to government affairs and, you know, dipped my toes in the water during the 87th legislative session, which I don't even know if that's considered dipping your toes in the water because, you know, if you remember, you had COVID going on and all that other good mess. So it really wasn't a full-on session. It was kind of a modified.
So 87th was your first. That was during COVID.
That was during COVID, yeah.
God, what was that like?
It was miserable. You know, you had to go there. You had to be there early, you know, go to the tent and
Get your nose rubbed.
Yes, I see that.
Well, obviously, one way of preventing disease is worth 50 ways of curing it.
And it was not a pleasant feeling. So you had to do that every day because you never knew which office was going to say, oh, if you don't have your clearance card, if you, you know, don't have a little wristband showing that you tested negative today, then you can't come in.
Oh, that's right. They had the military GP tents at the north end of the building.
It's crazy.
And you got your nose swabbed every morning, didn't
every
you?
Morning, yeah. Every morning.
yeah. Lovely.
Yeah, so I think, you know, that put a 15-minute wait and so on everything. You know, so you had to leave 15 minutes early and then you had to pray to God that, you know, the EIOU one that was sitting in there in a military uniform didn't forget about you. Because that happened to me a couple times. You know, they swab you and you go back 30 minutes later. Hey, are y'all calling an ambulance for me? Are you fixing to quarantine me out of here or what? You know, and, oh, no, we forgot. We're sorry, you know. So
excuse me, private. I have a meeting.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, yeah, it was a challenge, to say the least. It was definitely a challenge.
So when you got in the ledge, have you always walked 30,000 steps a day, or was that something new for you?
No, that's where I learned how, you know, the footwear may look cool, but if it don't feel cool,
oh my gosh,
you threw them suckers in the trash really quick.
Yeah, the first time I went, I wore some god-awful dress shoes so that they look nice with my suit, and about halfway through the day, I thought, there is no way people do this every day in these ugly shoes.
No way. No. No. And for our listeners or members that have never been to the Capitol with some of the ledge guys, it is so impactful and so eye-opening, really, to walk the hallways with your senators and the ledge guys to see the work that they do. It's so it's crazy. I mean, because you're face-to-face with these guys and to see that they work that they do and talk about the bills and really because the laws that you're enforcing on a day-to-day basis – it really puts in perspective of how far to see it go from just a piece of paper to see
an idea.
Yeah, that's what's so interesting to me is to go from an idea to go to paper and it goes to a legislator's hands, and then the process, and I want you to talk to just talk about the process, because it is a lengthy process to go through all that, and then to go to a law to where an officer is actually making the arrest and go to the criminal justice system. It's really fascinating. It really is fascinating.
Yeah, it is a challenge. You know, I'll give you a great example. House Bill 1133 was filed, and that was an idea that I had coming into the session, and that stemmed from last year. I had a daughter that graduated high school, and you know, law enforcement has been really shorthanded. Yep. Nobody wants to be the police anymore because they're tired of everybody using them as a punching bag. And so last year, when my daughter graduated, they had a project graduation event that was scheduled. Where I live at our local sheriff's office was understaffed. They still are. Our local police department was understaffed. And so that was also not too long after the Uvalde incident.
Yep.
And then add to that, over in Bell County, there was a student that was stabbed and killed at Belton ISD. And so you know, a lot of the parents were really uneasy about, you know, a lot of gatherings with their
presence of law enforcement.
Yeah, you know, they wanted that. And so I reached out to my local sheriff and I said, "Hey, sheriff, do we have anybody working that down there?" And he says, "No, I just don't have anybody." In fact, I think he had to pull in reserves just to cover patrol shifts that night. The local police department, same way. And so I thought about it. I thought, man, if I could, I would put on my uniform and I would just go volunteer my time. But, you know, Bell County carries me as a reserve. And so I was not comfortable with the way the law was, because the law does not allow reserves to work security type jobs. In fact, you can catch a criminal conviction if you do it, you know, and I like my PID number, and I don't want to turn it into a SID number. So
right.
I just decided, no, I'm not going to do this. But what that did is that prompted, hey, you know what, why can't we do this? So I contacted my state representative, Representative Spiller.
Yeah.
Yep. Redistricting was weird. Representative Spiller has Lampasas County all the way up to the Red River.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, and so we talked to his office about it. I said, hey, you know what, here's what I'm trying to do. If a reserve officer wants to volunteer their time to protect kids or protect their church, they should be able to do that in a uniform and not worry about catching a criminal conviction.
Mm-hmm.
And he wholeheartedly agreed with me. And so there's the idea. There's a spark, right?
Yep.
That's the first step. The second step in that is you got to figure out, where do you put this in the code, and how do you put it in the code to where it doesn't have all these unintended consequences, these right. different things, right? And so one of the unintended consequences with that was we did not, and I agreed with this, and this is a bill that wasn't necessarily a Tmpa-backed bill. This is a JW, you know, trying to do more for his community. One thing I looked at is you know, we don't want to completely open the door to where any reserve can just go out and work security jobs and get paid for it, because that brings in a whole different realm of issues that are associated with it. So having to word that the correct way and then fend off the additional language that was trying to be put onto it, right? Because yeah. there were several bills that were filed during the session that I called them vendor bills. You know, there was a bill that was filed to try to make it to where any reserve could work jobs, you know, security jobs. And, you know, TMPA, you know, our board of directors said, no, we're not going to be in support of that. Okay, so that I have my marching orders. So now with my bill, I've got all these other bills that were filed trying to get that done. Now they're trying to tack it onto my bill. So I had to fend all that off while it's moving through the path. And, you know, so the first thing that it does is, you know, it's filed on the House side. It's got to go through a committee. During that committee, you give testimony if you're in support of it, if you're opposed to it. After it gets heard in committee, then you got to convince the committee chair to actually put that bill up for a vote, which means you got to go work all the other committee members and say, hey, you know, are you going to vote for this? And, you know, be able to go back to the chair and say, hey, you know what, we got the support for it. And then once it comes out of committee, then it goes to the calendars committee. So now you got to go work that committee to try to get them to vote to put it actually out on the House floor. And then once it comes out on the House floor, it comes up for second reading. And that's where all the amendments are typically attached to it. And so you got to be watching for those. And part of the problem there is you can attach an amendment to that bill, and you may not be able to see what that amendment does. So you have to have a really close relationship with legislators so that way when they get it, you have a well enough relationship with them that they're going to share that with you. And then they're going to ask you, hey, what does this do? Is it good? Is it bad? And then you let them know about that. After it makes through second reading, it goes through third reading, and hopefully it passes. 1133 passed unanimously out of the House, and then it goes over to the Senate side where it starts that process all over again. So
what this equates to our members, kind of boil it down, is it doesn't just take somebody like J-Dub to get an idea. Stephen Delafos, one of our K-9 members at Bel Air PD, several years ago, he's sitting around. He's like, dude, we don't have a K-9 anymore. We lose a lot of K-9s. He calls past President James Babb. They BS, the idea spawns. Some past presidents, Tmpa get on board. We now have a K-9 memorial coming. There was funding issue coming up. Past President Lon Craft just wrote a check to cover it. And that all started with
an idea.
Steven at Bel Air PD going, dude, most states have a K-9 memorial. We don't. Tmpa member sitting at home made a phone call, and shout out to Steven and past President Babb for getting that rolling. But it's somebody sitting at home on their couch, and now we're going to have a memorial.
Yep.
So for our members, it doesn't take somebody like J-Dub that knows how things work up and down and forward and how to massage things through. If you have something, bring it to Tmpa.
Yeah, that's a great point, Clint. And we can't stress that enough. I mean, you know, there were a little over 8,000 bills that were filed during the session, you know, both on the House side and the Senate side. And that's not including all the joint resolutions and House resolutions. And so one of our biggest things is that we have to be monitoring all those bills and figure out, are they good for law enforcement? Are they bad for law enforcement? Do they open up a door to branch off into one of those directions? So our hands are already filled with that. And when one of our members has a good idea or an idea for a legislative bill, bring that to us. That's what we're here for. We are here to not only fend off and you know, take care of the bills that everybody else are filing, but to work with our members and say, hey, you know what? Yeah, all right, that looks like a good idea. Let's get it to our board of directors. If our board of directors say, yep, we're going to carry forward with the torch, then it's our job to make sure that we're doing everything we can to make sure that that bill makes its way through the House and makes its way through the Senate and onto the governor's desk.
But I want to touch on that real quick, because right now, I don't want our members to think that it's okay to call you in mid-session and say, hey, J-Dub, I've got an idea, and I want you guys to go ahead and push forward with this. Because
the session ends in 4 weeks.
The session ends in 4 weeks. Yeah. Right now is the time to call you and say, hey, we've got the 89th session coming up in 2 years. I've got an idea, and I want to start working on it now. Because right now is the time to start working on the bills for the next session. Now is the time to call our ledge team and say, hey, I've got this idea, and let's start lobbying for this bill now. Not in the middle of session, not 2 weeks before session, not even 3 months before session. We could do it, possibly. But now is the time to prepare this for the next session ahead of time.
Yeah, and a great example on that, and you're absolutely right. If you have a legislative idea, if one of our members out there says, you know what, I've just been thinking about this, now's the time to get in contact with us. Yeah, during the 87th, like I said, it was my first session, and one of the things that was tasked on me was the whole workers' comp stuff. And, you know, I went in there, and I just thought, man, I've been through the system. I've seen how it works. I've felt how it works, and it doesn't work. So, man, what would make that work? Oh, you know what? This would make that work. So I go in, and I make one sentence. That was it. And I gave it to Representative Patterson's office, his chief of staff at the time, Madeline. Great chief of staff. And I said, hey, what do y'all feel about this? And she said, I like it. Let me run it past the boss. So she runs it past Representative Patterson, and he says, oh, yeah, I'm all for it. Well, then that language is sent over to Texas Department of Insurance, Division of Workers' Comp. And they said, well, hey, that's great, but if you do that, it's going to change this code, that code, this code, this code, that code, that code, this rule, those rules, this rule, that rule, and that code. And so I just basically had to bow down and say, yeah, let's just pull the plug on this, and let me take all interim to work on this and get back with you. And that's what we ended up having to do. So, you know, I was of the same mindset. Oh, I've got this great idea. Well, why don't we just get it turned into law real quick? That doesn't work. Now is the time.
And to John's credit, when he said he had to bow out or whatever and reevaluate, to John's credit, he took between the 87th and the 88th, and I would almost say could testify as an expert on workers' comp. He didn't just take a surface look and see, well, what could I do? He spent an enormous amount of freaking time researching, understanding, vetting the information, vetting the facts he was finding, and can talk forward, backwards, inside and out about workers' comp. And I would rather run a belt sander across my forehead for an hour than listen to anything about workers' comp. And so kudos to you, brother, for taking the time on behalf of our members to understand, to truly understand how it works, but it doesn't work.
Yeah.
What that process is and the failures in that process and some possible good changes to make that occur. Cause man, that was a hell of an undertaking. I don't have the
patience bandwidth
to, yeah. to wrap my mind around that. And listening to you explain it to people, I'm like, shit, he got over my head like 4 seconds into the conversation. Kudos to you on behalf of our members for digging into that, because workers' comp is broken as hell and desperately and literally. I was on workers' comp last week where, like, yeah, nobody will approve surgery, yet they tell me I need physical therapy and they won't approve physical therapy, and so I'm sitting here with an injury, and I mean, literally, it's still a friggin' problem, and no matter how hard we work, try, but it takes relentless work. And man, it is truly appreciated, brother.
Yep. Well, we didn't get it passed this session, you know, not for lack of trying. We got it passed out of the House unanimously. It landed over in the Senate, landed in Senator Schwertner's.
But it wasn't committee. For lack of effort on your part, because be clear, we have a strong lobby there. Law enforcement has a strong lobby, but you got to understand, every time we propose something, somebody on the other side of that has an equal lobbyist down there fighting like hell. So you have Texas Department of Insurance, you have all these other people who have their lawyers down there telling our legislators that these bills are bad or this is not good or these dumb cops over here trying to propose this.
Just, and I want to clarify, so TDI, Texas Department of Insurance, they're not allowed to lobby. So it wasn't them, it was the insurance companies. It was Texas Municipal League, which – you know, they do most of the workers' comp insurance for municipalities and Texas Association of Counties. They're the two that are on record testifying against their workers' comp bill.
Yeah, which is interesting because in the last episode or one of the last episodes, we talked about TAC and TML, you know, are not here for your F5 or your due process. They're not here to care about your workers' comp. They are not here on your behalf, contrary to what most people think.
No, they are there for your employer. That's it. And your employer's bottom dollar. That's it.
That's sad.
Yeah, so, you know, we look at this, you know, like I was saying, you know, so just to recap on that, if you have an idea for legislative idea for, you know, something to become law, now's the time to get a hold of us. Now's the time to bring it to us. So that way we can start kicking it around internally, get it to our board of directors, get guidance from our board of directors, and then start working on it, you know, now. Because here's, you know, one of the things that happens, and we do have to be really careful on how much we take on during a session. So we try to prioritize them. Because like I was talking about, I mean, we had a little over 8,000 bills that were filed. And just, you know, I want to walk you through that picture, what that looks like, right? So when these bills are being filed, the ledge team, we look at that bill, we read the caption of it, and does it look like that could possibly affect our members? And when I say affect our members, I'm saying
all of them.
All of them, yeah. So, you know, peace officers that are out there working, jailers that are out there working, anybody that can be a member, you know, we have to look at that and evaluate that. But then we're looking at not only how we do our job, as in when we put on that uniform and we go out there and we work that street and we take those calls, but we're also talking about the labor side of it. You know, not all the bills are focused just on criminal law. You know, you have some that are focused on the labor side. You have some that are focused on, like, the Tico Sunset bill, you know, more of the regulatory side of it. So, you know, we got to read all those over. And you know, once we identify, okay, this could potentially impact our member, then we flag it. And out of the flagged bills, so out of that 8,000, we flagged just under 1,600 of those bills, which means now we have them flagged. If any of them get movement, if any of them are called up for a committee hearing, Now that triggers the next step. You go in and you read that bill, and that could be a one-page bill. It could be a 35-page bill. Now you got to go in and you got to read that bill. You got to read all the sections of it, and you got to understand exactly what this bill does to our members. And is it a good thing or is it a bad thing?
Can I stop you? That's one of J-Dub's really strong points is when he evaluates a bill. Again, I like the bandwidth and watching J-Dub go through a bill and understanding, is it shall or may? How one word in a bill can affect how that bill is imposed or how it affects law enforcement. And literally you go through a 10-page bill and you see a few words in there that you realize this word right here is a problem, or where it says, you know, if this, then this. Well, now you have to go research over in the transportation code, what does it mean when it's referring to that over there? Or simply, we are always telling guys, does it say shall or may do? And man, to do that over and over, and you start talking about 1,600 bills, and most bills aren't two sentences. And so, I mean, it is time-consuming, the brain capacity that it takes to continue to do that and stay involved and stay aware, because if something slips through, you know, I mean, then we're the bad guys on that.
Right. Yeah, the way he dissects it and transcribes it to where our members, not saying our members are not as smart as him, but think about it.
No, he puts it in layman terms, so
there you go. Man,
so can yeah. Go ahead and say it so a Marine can read it.
Yeah, that's right. Right. A crayon can eat.
Yeah. Go ahead. That's why we took the crayons out of the meeting room.
That's right.
Had a couple too many jarheads in there, but yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right, Clint. You know, you have to be able to go in and you have to look at that, and so. I really hope our members don't get offended when they call us during session. They say, oh, I want to know about House Bill 4229. Like, okay, what bill is that? Well, you work down there, you ought to know. Well, you know, I'm tracking about 1,600 bills right now. Right. So, you know, and then we pull it up and we look at it. And this is one of the more frustrating parts of the job is, you know, we are 100% responsive to our members. And I cannot tell you how many times our members would call up. It happened a handful of times where they would, you know, they're on some social media chat group or they're listening to their buddies standing around the coffee machine or something like, oh, did you hear about this bill, Tyler? Man, this bill is going to take away our retirement and everything else, man. This is wrong. I'm going to get a hold of somebody at TMPA. And here it is. You know, you got 3 days left in session and they're calling you about this because somebody told them about it. And you pull up the bill and it was filed and never got a hearing. And you're like, buddy, that bill's DRT. It is dead right there. That bill ain't going anywhere.
Well, just so we're clear, if it's on Facebook, it is true.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Yeah, yep. Yeah, the fact checkers over there, right? You know, so out of nearly that 1,600, you know, almost 1,000 of them, 997 of those bills actually went to a hearing, which means out of those 997, now we have to fully go in and read those bills, look at them. But here's a kicker for you. Just about every one of those bills had a committee substitute. Because everybody was in a hurry to file a bill. They wanted to get the bill filed, get it filed. And Ledge Council, which is the attorney, so Tyler, if you're a legislator and you want to write a bill, you write up the draft and you send it over to the attorneys at Ledge Council, and then they look at it, they word it the way that the law is supposed to be worded, all that kind of good stuff, and they send it back over to you. Well, if you're coming up against a deadline to get the bills filed, you're like, I'm just going to file it, and then whenever I get this copy back, I'll file that copy as alleged counsel.
It's kind of a placeholder so you have something there. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And so now when you go to committee, now the legislator is walking into the committee room and they're going to lay out the bill and they're going to lay out the committee sub. You may have not even seen that committee sub yet because they may have gotten it back 15 minutes before they walked in that room.
Oh.
So now you got to stop everything you're doing, pull that, look at it and go, oh man, I'm registered in support of this bill. Yeah, we're still in support, or oh god, this is really no, this ain't good anymore. Now I got to change and, you know, be in opposition to this bill or be neutral on the bill or just provide some feedback. Yeah. So, you know, there's that aspect of it. And, you know, so out of that 997, we were looking at just a little under 420, I think it was like 418 bills that we found were good for law enforcement. Okay, that's great, they're good for law enforcement. So, a lot of people think there's nothing to do on that. No, there's a lot to do on that.
Oh, yes.
You know, if it's good for law enforcement, you can do everything you can to kind of help it, you know, grease the skids for it, you know, get it across that finish line. But then you also have to watch out for the attacks getting lumped onto it.
Yep.
Because once it hits that House floor, you know, anybody can drop an amendment on it, and all it takes is the majority of the House floor to approve that amendment. So you could start off with a bill that was really good for law enforcement, and by the time it's said and done and over with, now it's bad for law enforcement. So
That's another thing I want to interrupt to make sure people understand is the late hours you guys keep, because as the session goes on, January and February session's pretty dead.
Yeah.
As it ramps up, it's a crescendo where it rises, and their days go from 8 or 9 hours to, if you have a committee going until midnight, These guys are they've got to either be in the committee or they have to be watching live to figure out what's going on. Because if somebody proposes an amendment, or later on, if a rider is attached to a bill, it can totally change the entire spirit of the bill of how it began. So what may be a really great bill?
Well, just prime example, like the canine, like the member. What was the member's name?
Stephen Delfos.
If Stephen put the his idea, his sole purpose of that canine memorial was to have a canine memorial on the Capitol grounds. Okay. So let's say that I'm a state rep and I'm anti-law enforcement. I don't want anything to do with the canine memorial on the Capitol grounds. And I drop an amendment that says, okay, I don't want this canine memorial anywhere near the Capitol grounds, just like we have the Texas Peace Officer Memorial. I'm going to drop an amendment that says the canine memorial can only be 12 inches by 12 inches on the south side of the memorial. And only
be to be a house cat memorial.
That's right. And it slips by.
Yeah.
The whole sole purpose of that memorial is shot. You and I both know that.
But I think Stephen would still like a house cat memorial. Yeah. He's a good guy. I think he'd still be proud of that.
But you see what I'm saying? So, but that could happen.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so,
But then the opposite side of that could happen too. And Tyler, but
that may happen at 1 a.m. Literally.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
That goes on at 1 a.m. Mm-hmm. sometimes.
And sometimes it's, you know, you may think that it's not going to happen. And I'll give you a great example of that. House Bill 30 that was filed. You know, that bill was filed as in response to the school shootings. The legislators wanted information. The family members of the victims wanted information. And they weren't getting the information because there's still active investigations. And, yep. and so it's not subject to the open records. And so the representative filed HB 30, and it was sold as, well, this is basically going to give the families closure, and it's going to give legislators more information. What was actually contained in that bill was that it opened up our officers, our members' complete personnel file to a FOIA request. And so the title says one thing, and, you know, we have this saying in government affairs, the devil's in the details, and that devil was right there in those details. And, you know, that's just another shining example of you have to know what's in those bills. And sometimes you don't have long to figure it out because these things are moving. And that particular bill, we thought was dead. You know, we really did. We thought, okay, this, yeah, you know, he got it out of the House, but we have commitment from the Senate that it's not going to go anywhere. Well, what ends up happening is now the Senate has their bill that they want to get across the finish line. And now somebody in the House who is responsible for helping it get across that finish line, they say, well, you know what? I got your bill here. I'm in charge of that committee. It's my call whether or not that bill gets a hearing. What are you doing with my HB 30 over there? And so then you have those ransoms, right? They're holding hostage. They're holding bills for hostage to get something else done. And that's what ended up happening with HB 30. Now, granted, because we have a good relationship with Senator King, you know, Senator King, you know, assured us that nothing bad was going to be in that bill that came out that negatively impacted our members. And that's exactly what happened. HB 30 did pass, but all that bad stuff about opening up our files, all that was stripped out of the bill.
For our members, what would you say are five results out of the 88 that affects them that they should be aware of, and timelines on those? Or most, would you say most laws are September 1?
Yeah, most of them are, yes. Some of them maybe even pushing a little further past just because there's so many changes to it that they have to give the state agencies time to get the rules adopted on them. Yeah. But, you know, one of those is, you know, give shout out to T.O. over here. You know,
who's that?
Tyler Owen. This.
Oh, me.
Oh.
The.
Whoa. Yeah. Tyler.
Yeah. So, you know, last session.
TFO bill. Is it a TFO bill?
No, it's not a task force officer bill.
It's actually an education bill, which it surprised me, you know, coming from. But anyways.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So, you guys are harsh.
Jesus. So, yeah. So, Tyler, you know, Tyler brought it to the ledge team last session about, you know, the peace officer school transfer bill that would allow, you know, officers who, you know, who have kids in school, and maybe those kids are facing harder times because of what their parents are doing. Yeah. As a profession, you know, for those kids to be able to be transferred to another school district.
Like striking.
without a fee, without a fine, anything like that. And so last session it passed out of the House, but it didn't go through the Senate because it ran out of time. And so this session it was picked back up by the incoming freshman state representative. And, man, it sailed out of the House, made it its way over to the Senate, sailed out of the Senate, and that bill actually became effective June 2nd, that, you know, for the 2023 school year, 2023 to 2024 school year, you can now transfer your child to any neighboring school district without having to pay a fee for it.
And there was some discussion. Does there have to be some threat or some possible threat or some issue at hand, or is it strictly you can transfer your kid?
So it originally started off with there needing to be a threat. And somewhere along the road, that got stripped out, which is a good thing. You know, that got taken out. So right now, there does not have to be a threat. There does not have to be any retaliatory act against your children. You don't have to do any of that. Right now, the way the law is worded is that peace officer can transfer them to a different school district.
And for our listeners not in law enforcement arena, so that you can understand the levity of that, and shout out to T.O. for a damn good bill. But the levity of that, we had an officer in North Texas years ago, got involved in a shooting, and a smaller community right next to Dallas, not a small community, but a smaller community right next to Dallas, unbeknownst to him, well, his kids come home the next day upset, crying, elementary school age kids crying that all the kids at school are calling my daddy a murderer, their daddy the policeman. Unbeknownst to them, bad guy that their daddy had to kill because he chose to pull a gun on him, his kids went to that school also.
Oh, wow.
And they were telling everybody that, you know, little Johnny's daddy murdered my daddy for no reason. Little Johnny's daddy murdered my daddy. And so that's what these kids were hearing all day, is that my daddy's and he was a hero.
Yep.
And an example for non-law enforcement listeners to understand exactly how important this bill is.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, that's like we were saying earlier, you know, not all of the bills that we track, not all of the bills that we work on deals with how an officer does his job. You know, some of them deal with making sure that officer has peace of mind, knowing that his kids are okay during the school day and not, you know, not having to suffer because he or she has decided to become a police officer. Another good one that becomes law on September 1st that we worked on. It's another one that we worked on for a couple sessions now. And again, an idea that came to us out of Williamson County, our members there in Wilco, brought to us as a cold case related issue about doing away with the statute of limitations for tampering with evidence when somebody moves a body or moves evidence that was associated with a homicide. We worked on that last session. We worked on it again this session. And this session, we got it passed through both chambers. The governor signed it. And so now, effective September 1, if you tamper with a body, you know, that was part of a homicide, or if you tampered with evidence that a reasonable person should have known was associated with that homicide, you cannot be prosecuted until the day you die. And that's a good thing for criminal justice.
And shout out to Tmpa member Gary Sweet,
yep,
my old partner from Garland PD homicide, that came down and testified on that bill.
Yep, member Gary came down and testified, and we had one of the detectives from Williamson County. I cannot recall her name right now to save my life, but you know, both of those were very instrumental. You know, coming down and sharing their stories, and that's what moves. Now, that being said, you know, there's a great that I think there's a great time to talk about that, Clint. If we always want our members to come in and talk, tell their story. But we also have to remind our members that a lot of the legislators, they entertain the story, but they may not want to hear it. And the reason for that is because they may be scheduled to hear 40 bills during that hearing, and they didn't get started at time or on time because, you know, hearing was set for 10 a.m., and now here it is. You know, they were on the floor until 2 p.m., and now they're just now getting started, and the chairman put 40 bills to be heard, which is a god-awful lot, which we saw this past session. And so now everybody's coming up, and they're trying to tell their story, and nobody understands what 3 minutes means. I mean, nobody does. And so when you get with us, and if you're going to come in and testify on a bill, there may, in fact, be times where we're evaluating the situation. And we may tell you, hey, you know what, when the chair calls you, it'd be really smart for you to just say, I'm here to answer any questions if you need. Because we see, you know, and Senator Whitmire on the Senate side is notorious for this. he'll tell you the bill's in good shape, which means don't sit here and take up all of our time telling your war stories, because you're just going to aggravate everybody.
Yeah.
So just be mindful of that. We understand everybody has a story. We understand that. But if we make the audible call and tell you that, it's for a reason. It's not for anything else, but we don't want your bill in jeopardy.
The game's going well.
Yeah.
We're good.
You know, another great one is the recall provisions for DAs. You know, that was a great bill. You know, Tmpa, we have some different language that we were hoping for. It didn't get filed, but we evaluated HB 17, and you know, by Representative Cook, and you know, it was a good bill. It would help get it accomplished. It would help accomplish getting some of these DAs removed out of office that don't need to be there. So that one's good, and it takes effect September 1st as well. And then another great one, again, another, you know, holdover from last session. You know, we worked on the workers' comp bill last year with Representative Patterson, and some of them that we were working with was the Association of Firefighters. So, you know, in between their naps and, you know, their breaks with Call of Duty or, you know, whatever
cooking steaks, working out. Yeah.
You know, in between that, you know, we would work with them, and you know, they had a really good bill, and we teamed up with them on that bill. We worked with them really good on that bill. And I feel bad for them, because all of the stuff that they wanted in that bill got stripped in the Senate. The one thing that we wanted in there, and we worked with Glenda Shields, is a great guy. He's got he knows what he's doing down there at the Capitol, and I've always you know, found it real pleasant to work with Glenn on these issues. And so on the law enforcement and firefighter side, we felt that, you know, every officer, every firefighter that gets injured in the line of duty, they should all have at least a year of injury leave. You know, all civil service agencies have it, but so many agencies out there are not civil service. And so basically it's 12 weeks of FMLA, and then the agency can get rid of you if they want to. So House Bill 471 originally had a lot of stuff in there for the firefighters. It passed out of the House. It got over the Senate side, and the insurance companies went in and did their stuff, and they stripped out everything with the exception of the one section that gives one-year injury leave to every law enforcement officer.
What is it currently?
I'm sorry?
What is it currently? Just out of curiosity.
Well, it depends.
Non-civil service, it's 12 weeks of FMLA, and then you're gone. Civil service, it's a year.
Unless you work for an elected official.
Right. Oh, yep.
And, you know, if you work for an elected official, you know, that sheriff cannot terminate your employment simply because you're injured until that sheriff leaves office.
Does that vary per county? I mean, I guess what
not? No, that's in the Texas Constitution, so it's statewide.
I didn't mean sheriff. I'm talking about, does it vary? So if you work for a constable's office or anything, that does not, each county is the same.
Right.
So it's repeat that again for the listener and for the watcher viewer.
Yeah, so if you work for an elected official, and that's the way it is in the
Constitution. So every county employee is the same, which is?
If they're law enforcement, not, you know, we're not talking about road crews, stuff like that. We're talking about your jailers. I mean, your jailers and your sheriff's deputies, your constable deputies. You know, it's records clerk and those folks, they're not going to be covered under it,
right?
Because of the wording. But, you know, yes, the deputies, if they get injured on the job, the entity cannot terminate their employment simply because they're injured until that elected official leaves office.
Okay.
And then TMPA, we've had to educate some counties on that. A couple years back, we had to educate Travis County on it because the deputy constable got hurt and they tried to get rid of him.
Right.
So the good part about 471 is that, and that one went into effect June 12th. So any of our members, and they don't have to be our member, but any law enforcement officer working in the state of Texas that was injured on or after June 12th, they now have 1 year of injury leave to get better. So all the same protections under 143 as it relates to that injury leave, that now applies to every officer across the state of Texas, which is huge for our members.
Yeah, and again, for our non-LE listeners, you get in a bad car wreck, you get rear-ended by DWI, you get shot, 12 weeks isn't a whole lot of time to get better. Mm-mm. And to be told, yeah, I know you got both your legs broke, or I know you got severely injured, or you got shot, but your 12 weeks is up. Take care, move along. Appreciate your sacrifice for your community, but don't let the door hit you on the way out.
Yeah.
I mean, that is not acceptable.
And it's not. And just to throw one more little wrench in there, I guarantee you the entire time they're going to be arguing with the workers' comp insurance company.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. the entire time. We see it right now. We see members that work for a civil service agency that have that 1 year injury leave. They spend 9 months of it arguing with the insurance company to get the treatment that they need to get back to work.
Yep.
Yeah, that's crazy. So, you know, another one that goes into effect, 9-1. This is another one where our members reached out to us. In fact, we were driving back from the TCO conference last year and get a phone call from the sheriff in Milam County. He says, hey, you know, we have this law that says that, you know, agencies have to have a mental health leave policy for police officers. I said, yes, sir. He said, what about my dispatchers?
Man, that's cool.
He said, you know, my dispatcher was on the radio the night that one of my CIT deputies was shot in the face, and she is not taking it very well. And, you know, I don't have much room to do much with her because it's not in the statute like it is for my officers. Well, in between San Antonio and Corpus Christi, let's get that fixed. And so we got with the state rep, who was brand new, put the two of those in communication with each other. We worked out the language. We worked it everywhere that we could, and that's another bill that we got passed. You know, TMPA got that bill put into place, so now the dispatcher is going to be covered under that same mental health leave policy.
That's awesome, dude.
And shout out to that Milam County Sheriff for having the leadership and fortitude to do that.
Yeah, yep. And I want to touch one base on that because I get this question a lot. They ask, well, how come there's not a specified number of days in there? And I give a shout out to Clint on this because I didn't know how to answer that until I forget where I was, but I heard Clint saying this, and Clint explained it the best when he said, you know, that he's been to shootings. We, you know, everybody up here has been to officer-involved shootings, support those members. And Clint made the comment one time. He said, you know, I've been to shootings where you got a guy that's been in five or six shootings, and you get there and like, hey, man, you all right? Yeah, a little hungry, you know. Can you give me something to eat? And then you get the one who's, you know, been in law enforcement for 30 years, just gotten their first shooting, and they're inconsolable. So to have a blanket standard would probably do more harm than it would do good.
Right.
But now, if it starts getting abused and we need to address that in the future, by all means, bring us that information if you see it's being abused.
Yeah.
So, you know, there was a lot of bad bills that we got fended off. You know, a lot of the refiles, you know, we talked about HB 30 that would open up our personnel files. We got that. Then you had the bunch of the little sneaky bills, right? So, you know, good one on that, House Bill 4486. You know, it at face value, it sounds good. It was the model citation bill, right? It's the every agency needs to use the same citation.
Oh, God, yeah.
Well, you know, I don't disagree with that. I mean, it would make it easier to train officers and so forth. Well, the problem with that is remember the devil's in the details. Also included in that bill was the agencies also have to adopt a policy that says you cannot arrest for Class C's only. So little things like that you always have to watch out for. So we got, you know, we got a lot of those killed off, and not real. I don't know that there's any that passed that was just terrible. And in fact, I think if anything was terrible that we have to reflect back on from the session, it would probably be, you know, losing the F5 hearings at part of the TCO sunset.
Horrible,
bill.
Horrible.
Yeah.
I'll tell you one we're facing. I'm on the security board for the Forney ISD school district. And one of the laws that just passed requires a armed person at every school, which sounds great, and I'm all for it.
HB3.
I would be for 20 armed people at every school. Problem is implementation of that, there was really no amount of money, not an adequate amount of money thrown at that, and it has to be ramped up, I think, fairly quick. And getting someone competent that you trust to have a weapon at every school in a district, and not every district is well funded, man, that's a challenge. That is a huge challenge. And I'm all for protecting our kids, and I'm all for making sure a good guy with a gun is there to stop a bad guy with a gun. But when you just come out and tell these districts that you're going to do this and you need to implement it, and by the way, here's a couple of dollars to help with that, with districts that are already strapped, man, that's a tall order. And
yeah.
I know specifically Forney just because I'm involved, but I know a bunch of other districts are like, good Lord, how do we comply with this and how do we make it work? And we don't want to give some more nuts with guns
right
to be up there at a school.
Yeah, and I mean, everything was so far across the spectrum. You know, I mean, they were talking, you know, about, you know, the guardianship program. They were talking about the school marshal program. They were talking about hiring retired military, you know, and you know, I'm a military veteran. Clint, I know you are as well. And you know as well as I do, there is a difference between the training level of a combat arms job and a non-combat arms job. And, you know, part of what I do for fun in my spare time, and that's where I make my extra gun money, is I teach firearms at the local police academy. And where I'm located at, we get a lot of military that come into that. And what I find is that a lot of the military that are non-combat arms, yeah, they were trained on the rifle, but they had hardly any training on the handgun whatsoever. Well, that's what they're going to be, you know, if they're selected and they're going into schools because the law would allow them to, and I'm not saying it does, but if it was ever changed that way, we got somebody that's never been really trained on a handgun, you know, that's now walking to schools with a handgun. Yep. You know, so, it, you know, there's the one thing I'll say about HB3 is the one thing, if I could go back and change anything, it would be I wish our members would have communicated better with us, our school ISD members.
Yeah.
I wish they would have communicated with us better because, again, I just gave you the numbers, over 8,000 bills. We can't know every intimate detail about every single bill. Right. And everything that changes. And then more importantly, you know, I've never been an ISD officer. I got plenty of experience as patrol, investigations, narcotics, that kind of stuff, but I never had the ambition to go into the schools. And so we rely on those subject matter experts to communicate with us. And what little bit of resources that we did have, you know, past board members, some members that we know that work in the ISDs, you know, I was feeding them bills all during the session saying, hey, you know, what's the deal here? And one of the things that we found is like you said, Clint, it may work for this school district, but not that school district. So yeah. We were getting conflicting information sometimes about whether or not this bill was actually good or not.
And I'm all for protecting kids. And I'm certainly not anti-Second Amendment, but trying to make something work that is forced upon you in a short amount of time without the funds to support it is a tall order. Because mm-hmm. Everybody wants to comply. Everybody wants to protect kids. But man, it's tough. It's tough in that short amount of time with the funding.
Well, and call it what you want to. I wouldn't want a bunch of Paul Blarts protecting my kids in the schools. I'll call a spade a spade.
Yep.
I mean,
well, and if you think about it, I mean, and you know, I don't want to air out too much of our dirty laundry, but I mean, what's the first thing to get cut when budgets hit? Training.
Yeah,
and we've seen that, and that's why right now, currently. You know, you have so many agencies out there, their officers, you know, their annual firearms training is not even training, it's annual proficiency. So once a year they go out and they fire 50 rounds out of their handgun to prove that they can hit the target 7 out of 10 times.
Well, and like John Sariga said the other day, right now with the amount of shortcomings with staffing right now with other police departments, law enforcement can't attend training right now anyway because of the staffing levels.
Right.
So how the hell are they going to – oh, that's right. I'm sorry. The John Sariga. So how the hell are they going to attend training for this anyway? So this whole rollout of this HB3 really wasn't – I'm not going to say thought through entirely. It wasn't thought through entirely.
Well, I'll say
– To a degree.
And I said it a couple episodes again, or somebody did. The best quote I've ever heard out of Kevin Lawrence is after the tragedy in Uvalde. For years, it was defund, demilitarize, quit being warriors for years. And when Kevin testified before the legislature and they asked, where were all the warriors? Kevin's response was, you sent them home. Mm-hmm. You sent them all home. All the warriors are gone because you didn't want them armed. You didn't demilitarize, quit being mean, quit being scary. Well, there's a time. And you got to be a guardian. And then you got to flip the switch like an Allen. You got to flip the switch and go exact violence
be
on someone in that short amount of time. And then we, not saying that the HB3 is bad or a 30 is bad, but we just got to be smart how we do all of these laws, because knee jerks don't fix anything.
Yeah.
And we're always trying to improve. And that's another point to some of our members is they call with an idea sometimes, and I've had them too. And then when you really look at it, implementing it, the idea sounds great or sounds sexy, but how you implement it, or is it really truly practical in the big picture? Because it's not just my community. You got to look at it because that law is going to affect the entire state.
Yep.
How does that roll out? How does that implement? Is it financeable? Is there a funding attached to that? What is that going to look like in the big picture? And that's part of what JW has to go through and determine as when those calls come in.
Yeah, that's – I think you hit the nail right on the head with that, Clint. Another great example, you know, we – the legislature passed what's going to be the Texas RICO Act, right? I don't know if y'all are tracking that. Part of my job now that session is, the regular session is over, is now I get to go in and I get to build the presentation for the legislative update class. And yesterday I was working on the Texas RICO bill. And
RICO, similar to the federal RICO?
Yeah.
Federal, similar. I said federal to you.
I like that.
Federal.
You know, TCO is named after TCO, like Tyler Owen. Anyway,
well, I just figured federal, like TFO.
Yeah, TFO.
I just want to point out federal to all of our listeners that TO just authorized us to blame everything wrong with TCO on him because he said named him after him, right?
I just said it was named after me. I didn't say everything.
Oh, well, that's not the story I'm going to tell.
They just spelt it wrong.
I second that.
They just spelt it wrong. Just throwing it out there.
But yeah, you know, I'm sitting there trying to put that together, and I'm finding this with so many bills now. Because you get these people that come in and they'll have an idea for a bill, and then they realize, oh, this touches all these different areas. And for so long, I think, for so long, they looked at it and they said, oh, man, that's really more complicated than what I wanted to put into this. But this session, they're putting in the work, you know, like the RICO bill. I mean, I'm sitting there going, good Lord, where does this go? Do I put this in the penal code section? Do I put it in the health and safety code? Do I put it in the CCP? Do I put it in civil remedies of practice code? Well, I had to put it in its own little section within the curriculum because, you know, and then there's a couple bills that I had to do that. And then a couple bills that I have to go through and I have to read and work my way through it and go, okay, which part of this really impacts the patrol level officer? Okay, well, there's about four sections in that bill that does that, but they're all in four different codes. So, you know, if you're attending one of our ledge update classes in the future, you're liable to see the same bill in about four different codes because these things are so intertwined with each other and you got to be able to go in and break out and extract all that information.
That's a great segue. When may our, we get a lot of requests about this time of year, knowing when Tmpa is going to roll out our ledge update class. When do you think that?
We are working on that soon.
Yep.
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Our goal, now granted, for anybody that does training that's reported through TCO, you understand this concept. We can put it together. We can have it ready tomorrow if we really, I mean, if we put the manpower to it, if we put 6-7 guys working, you know, all night tonight, we could probably have this thing ready tomorrow. But until TCO comes out with the instructor resource guide and we know that everything that we're talking about is covered in that guide, really we're at the mercy of that. And, you know, I talk to TCO. I stay in communication with them. We work with them really well.
Shout out to Gretchen.
Yeah. Gretchen is amazing, by the way.
She's a rock star.
You know, we reach out to them and we say, hey, you know, or I reached out to them the other day and I say, when do you think we're expecting the IRG? And the last word I got was they're expecting it at the end of this month. So later at the end of this month.
Cool. We're going to do something different this year. We're going to have a little mix up, a little stand up comedy, a little bit of rapping, country music. It's going to be cool. Y'all will be looking forward to it.
Yep.
Available on Amazon and Spotify. And it's going to be neat.
I like it.
It's going to be cool.
Yep. You know, and one thing, and I know we're winding down on time here. One thing I really want to drive into our members that are listening to these podcasts, and more specifically this particular one. Yeah, there's a lot of conversation on the TCO sunset bill that's going on out there. You know, we know we lost the ability to appeal a dishonorable F5 because they're going to no longer have the ability to give you a dishonorable F5 after March 1 of next year. After March 1 of next year, that basically the concept is we just notify TCO that you no longer work here and then let your personnel file speak for itself. Obviously, there could be a lot of potential issues with that, right? Because how do you control what's put in that personnel file? We fought tooth and nail to get something put into the code on that, you know, something standardized put in the occupations code. And I'll tell you, some of the language that we presented to them was that the officer, if something negative was put in their personnel file, they had the ability to appeal that to the governing body of their entity. So if they worked for a municipal police department and they didn't have civil service, then they could appeal it to the chief. And then if the chief didn't agree with, or the chief, if they didn't like what the chief said, then they could appeal it to the city manager, if it's a city manager form of government. And if not, then they can appeal it to the city council in you know, in your general law municipalities, right? And then from that, then they could appeal it to SOA. So, you know, we provided all kinds of language on this. I mean, we were, I can't tell you how many times we rewrote language because they'd come out to, well, you know, we just don't think this aspect is going to work because of this. Okay, we go back to the drawing board and we find a way to make it work and we present them with more language. And at the end of the day, I think we filled up all their trash cans with all of our language that we were trying to get them to consider on this. And what they ended up going with at the end of the day was they're going to be developing rules. And how they're going to develop those rules is by certain committees that are going to be formed, or by advisory committees. So those advisory committees will meet. They'll discuss the issues that are taking place. You know, there's three different advisory committees that they're looking at right now. There's one on minimum standards for law enforcement agencies. And so I know that there's been discussion in the past with some of the legislators saying, well, you know what, not every small town needs a police department. They can contract with a sheriff's office. They can do whatever. So, you know, if they can't afford to hire and keep quality cops, which actually who can right now, you know, if they can't afford to do that, then maybe they don't need to have a police department. So they said, all right, we're gonna put together a study panel on this to figure out what those standards are to have an agency to begin with. And then they're going to have another one that's going to be in place to talk about the examination of licensees. And when we talk about the examination, I'm not talking about you go to the academy and you take a TCOL test. I'm talking about for some reason somebody believes, Clint McNair, you're a patrol officer, and I just don't think you're fit for duty. So now I'm going to send you down for a fit for duty evaluation. And by the way, you have to comply with this. If you don't, TCOL can take your licenses away from you. So what are the rules that are going to be in place to make that happen, right?
Wow. To make them more of an enforcement agency.
Right.
Is that correct?
Yep. And then misconduct investigations and hiring procedures. And that's where the personnel file issue is really going to come into play. And you know, what's going to be considered a sufficient misconduct investigation and what's going to be considered good due process at the local level. So these advisory committees are going to listen to all this, they're going to take all this in, and then they're going to report that back. Whatever findings they have, they're going to report that back to the commission to adopt rules on that. And that's where, for our members that are listening, if you want to get involved, you need to be paying attention to TMPA social media. TO does a wonderful job at our social media. Yeah. And you know, I know I can go to TO and I can say, hey, I can go to TO and I can say, hey, man, this is an issue. This is popping off now. We got to get word out there. And I know he knows how to do that, and he'll get that out. So our members, be watching for that. If there's a bad rule that's being proposed, we may need you. Hey, you know what? You need to contact TCOL and you need to submit written response to this. And, oh, by the way, it probably wouldn't hurt for you to loop in your state representative on this as well. If something like that comes up and it's that bad, we may be asking our members to do that. It's going to be really important that they back or play on it.
Yeah.
I like it.
I agree.
I like it.
Well, man, you got anything else?
No, I appreciate you guys having me on.
Hey, man, we greatly appreciate you.
Hope
you,
I didn't go too far off.
No, absolutely not. You kicked ass this past session, and hopefully this third session is kind of a rumor. I'm sorry, this is the second special, right? The third.
We just finished the second special.
So we might be going to the third.
You know, everything's pointing that way.
Oh, God.
So one thing you got to remember is there were some bills that were vetoed. Because things weren't going the way that some felt they should during the first and second special.
And some good bills got vetoed just for a statement, correct?
Yes.
Collateral damage, not intentional.
Collateral damage. And so I would suspect that some of those may be kind of put in an area for a special called session to kind of maybe give them a little CPR and get them back to life.
Cross the finish line.
Yep.
Cool. Well, I have to wait and see. All right. We've already done the rapid fire questions. We've already got your answers on that one, so we don't want to
hit that. Crown Vic is still the best car.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. Hey, since we've already done rapid fire. Hey, Nat, stay on the wide shot. Come over here a minute, please. Yeah.
We want to give a shout out to Natalie. Come on.
Oh, come on. Can we?
This is our rock star, Natalie Garza. She's the one that runs our cameras, and she is absolutely amazing. Natalie?
Yes.
Welcome to the Blue Grit stage. Let the world see who you are.
Hello.
This is like the Wizard of Oz. She's always been this person behind the screen.
Yeah, get up on the mic. That way the world can hear you.
that actually works all the magic.
Yes.
This is, y'all are, you guys are getting to meet the Wizard of Oz. And a shout out to the Astros. She's got her Astros jersey on.
Yeah. Heck yeah.
Yep.
So
hello.
How do you tolerate us?
I mean, it's pretty easy. I love working
with
you all. It's a big family.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Well, we love you, Nat.
I love you guys.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Cool having Nat. She doesn't really have law enforcement background, really no family. Your sister worked here.
Yes.
Nat's been here for quite some time, came over and joined the field side. And she keeps all of this mess in order and keeps us moving forward. At conference, she works like a angry fire ant behind the scenes.
Yep.
Conference just wrapped up. How was that?
It was probably my favorite year, aside from the first year, just because, I don't know, something about this year, everything just fell into place. It was no stress. I mean, it was good.
Good year. It's a good conference, too.
Yep.
Good conference.
It was awesome. Natalie Garza, when you call down here trying to find one of these knuckleheads, you probably get her trying to help steer you in the right direction to find us or to get information to us, or you ask us a question that we don't know. We hung up and called Natalie and asked her, where's this at, or where is swag at, or where can you... She's the one that keeps this whole Jerry Springer episode moving in a forward direction. She's a rock star with us.
Greatly, greatly, greatly appreciate you.
You know that, you know that saying, behind every great man is a woman shaking her head. Well, kind of the same situation here. You know, behind all of our greatness, we have people like Natalie that just keep us in line and do so much for us.
Yep.
We just cannot say how much we appreciate you.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Well,
you didn't know you were going to do that. No,
you did not. You caught her completely off guard.
Not at all.
Well, this wraps everything up. Man, you guys stay safe. And be sure to check out Saving Heroes Places Gala. That's coming up in a couple months. Hit their Facebook.
Mississippi on the coast.
Yeah, that's right. And it's supposed to be a really, really, really nice hotel. I'm hopeful that me and Janet are going to take our trip out there to maybe take or check that out. So hit their Facebook up. You guys may buy tickets to that. Support that good cause. They are amazing, amazing people, and it's an amazing mission. Hit that up. Subscribe. Like. Be nice to Clint whenever you guys leave the review. Be safe out there. God bless you. And as always, may God bless Texas. We're out.